over here, which kind of doesn't have that much connection to the surrounding areas. A big problem, if you know, if you look down up at Brook Street and you look at the university buildings, both old and new, they almost form a wall, a barrier between the Brunswick and the Longside communities, or Charlie Medlock communities. But the entrances to those buildings are on the other side. So the campus looks in on itself, it doesn't look outwards to the surrounding communities. And this wasn't really what was in the 1945 reconstruction plan. When you go to that document, what it talks about this area becoming is the Bloomsbury of Manchester. The way they revisioned the higher education precinct was on the University of London model, where they kind of imagined a campus integrated within the city, linked by artists and academics and journalists, and what it calls, amusingly, cosmopolitans, whatever they are, cocktails might be, I don't know. But this whole area was actually envisaged as some kind of bohemian enclave servicing the university. So it was the idea that the academics would live in this area and work at a university, and it'd be a very, like a London neighbourhood. And quite clearly, it doesn't serve that purpose. Although I do know of many artists and musicians who live in this area, because it's the only bit of public housing within walking distance of the city centre, which so it still got offers cheap housing solution to many local people who would otherwise be forced further out from the city centre. So it still functions in some way. But there's this kind of disconnection, you know, why isn't this management regime, which has improved the footfall that side, continued into this space? And then you see other problems here. This is where people literally live with the Mancunian Way. Not only have you got the noise and the air quality pollution, you've got this huge lamppost here, which don't really serve any purpose, is what we can work out. But you've got these, I think it's sodium phosphate luminaires in there, very highly energy inefficient, constantly shining into your bedroom throughout the day, the night time. So it makes it very difficult for people to sleep, not only because of the noise, but also because of the lighting as well. So the way that, you know, this neighbourhood integrates within, you know, the structure of the Mancunian Way and its management is not well thought out, particularly for the needs of local residents. Cheap accommodation is where you tend to find creative people, because they need access to cheap space. And you know, the game goes back to this issue around affordable housing, that when you begin to price people out of space, you also begin to price certain people out of space as well. And it's always a dilemma with regeneration strategies. It's that it leads to what's called creative destruction. So a great example of this is the Lower East Side in New York, which kind of was colonised in the 60s by artists because there was lots of cheap tenement apartment blocks, sometimes free. The idea of studio or loft living comes from that period in New York. But the problem is that, you know, as these places became more desirable, it attracted in people with more money, investment, it led to increasing rates, rents and capital value. No. It's becoming expensive, but that's the issue. So it gets to this tipping point where that original community who defined the artistic identity could no longer afford to live in that space. And look, if you go to those parts of the Lower East Side which were colonised by artists in the 60s, it's now full of Wall Street bankers and, you know, very much from the corporate. The artists have gone elsewhere in New York now. Not to say they didn't gain out of that. Yeah, well, we'll carry on with that. She normally talks about her experience of living day by day with the Mancunian Way. I mentioned some of those things already, the noise, air quality. But what she also talks about is the Mancunian Way, for her, is a moat. It's not necessarily a barrier, or it's a positive barrier, but in the sense that it helps define this neighbourhood. So keeping people off this estate who they'd rather not see on this estate. So there's a different way of thinking about spatiality, that planners will go, it's a barrier, we need to increase the porosity of the Mancunian Way to improve pedestrian access, but there is this kind of, you know, very reflexive comment that Maury makes, is that, well, if this area became integrated into the city sort of regeneration, then at what point do we begin to get people wanting to buy up these flats, spending lots of money, will this price the people out of this area? Will it lead to the privatisation of this estate? Because I'm sure there's lots of private developers who'd love to get their hands on some of these blocks, either demolish them or refurbish them, and then sell them on at £200,000 a piece. That's the danger, you know, so that in a way, keeping that level of disconnection is a positive thing. And this is the issues often planners get, you know, when it comes to community consultations, that community people say things like this, which go against conventional thinking or their own conventional thinking. So it does create this dilemma. You know, I'm not saying this area doesn't need improvement, or it needs kind of, you know, some investment on it, maybe, in terms of public realm improvements. Maybe it does need more facilities, shops, and things like that. But does it need regenerating is the big question. Okay, I just need to point out this here.
What's that?
It has a dual function. It's an electricity substation, but it's one of the most barricaded substations in Manchester. Now, you might think, why is that the case? But this is because this is one of the entrance points to something called the Manchester Guardian, which is a tunnel which runs under the city centre, which was constructed in the post-war period as a nuclear defence shelter. So the idea would be that the city's great and the good could retreat quickly into the safety and security of the tunnel, and keep functioning government going in this area in a post-nuclear holocaust. And quite clearly that never happened, and quite clearly it would have served no protection whatsoever given what the Russians were going to throw at this area. But it still exists, and today, and what it actually is a very handy conduit for fibre optic cables going across the city. So what you've got in there are electricity links, telecommunication lines, and I think it's going back about 10-15 years now, there was a fire in the tunnel which basically knocked out the whole city centre's telecommunication networks for a period of days. Hence now it's heavily guarded, because if you wanted to orchestrate a terrorist attack on Manchester, this is one of your key targets, which is why it's so difficult to get in there, and also so difficult to negotiate access to get in there as well, because of the sensitivity of this new infrastructure that's in place there, which is a telecommunications infrastructure rather than, say, a road or rail infrastructure. So that's what goes on in there. This tunnel, I think, goes about half a mile that way, right through to Town Hall. If you go to the InfraManc exhibition at Kew, it's got the photographs of the interior, so you can see what it's like. But it is very difficult to get in there.
Is that the door there then?
Yeah.
That's it.
There's about four or five of these access points along the route. So it would be nice to get down there, but not to go.